students, today we are going to discuss the types of nuclear reaction. So the nuclear reaction types depend upon whether the energy of the incoming particle, that is the projectile, is carrying high energy, low energy, what is the charge carried on the incident particle, what is the nature of the incident particle, whether it is a photon, it is alpha particle, beta particle. So all these factors contributes to the types of nuclear reaction, and also what are the products formed in the nuclear reaction also leads to the types of nuclear reaction. So let us study what could be the various types. So the first type is the nuclear particle reaction and the scattering process. So in the nuclear scattering process, what happens that this process depends upon the nature of the projectile and the target nucleus. Where the nature of the projectile and the target nucleus is not changed upon the product formation. So the outgoing particle and the product nucleus is same as the incoming particle and the target nucleus. What changes here in this reaction is the amount of energy. There is just a redistribution of energy in the scattering process. So the scattering process is also further divided into two types of scatterings. First is elastic scattering and second is the inelastic scattering. In the elastic scattering, what happens that the kinetic energy of the reaction before the reaction and kinetic energy after the reaction, that remains same. Means there is just a redistribution of energy between the products and the reactants. Second point, the kinetic energy is transferred from the projectile to the target nucleus. This means that the target nucleus, which was incidentally at rest, was struck by a highly moving incoming particle. So the product nucleus, which is itself the target nucleus, is just now moving with some amount of energy that is imparted to the target nucleus by the projectile, and the outgoing particle is now a little bit slower than the incoming particle. So there is just a redistribution of energy and the target remains in the same internal or the nuclear state before or after the reaction. So what we see in this reaction, that A plus X forms X plus A, means the X, the target nucleus, remains the same whether it is a product or it is a target, and the incoming and the outgoing particles also remains the same, but there is a redistribution of energy. Kinetic energy on the reactant is equal to the sum of the kinetic energy on the product. So here the uranium was fired by neutron, so it has just moved the uranium in some direction and a neutron is also moving in other direction, that was its incident direction. So this happens in the elastic collision. So second is the inelastic scattering. So in the inelastic scattering, the total kinetic energy of the system, what system, of the projectile and the target, that kinetic energy has decreased because some part of the kinetic energy of this reactant system has given to the product to excite to the higher excited state, and outgoing particle is same as the incoming particle. So the kinetic energy of the system has decreased by the amount of the excitation energy given to the target nucleus, and the target nucleus is raised to an excited state, where this excited target nucleus comes back to the ground state by liberating one or more photons. So therefore there is a decrease in the kinetic energy of the system in the inelastic scattering. So here we have that the neutron strikes the lead to make the lead to carry on to the higher excited state, and a neutron is also emitted again, where this lead drops back to the ground state by emitting a photon. So this we have in the elastic and inelastic scattering. So the second type of scattering or second type of nuclear reaction is that the radiative capture. So what happens in the radiative capture, that whenever a low energy particle, we have to remember that the projectile is carrying a low energy. The projectile could be any proton, alpha particle, neutron, it could be any projectile, but it is carrying a low energy. So when this low energy projectile is fired on the target nucleus, it makes a compound nucleus, and this compound nucleus is excited to a higher state. So the compound nucleus thus formed is does not disintegrating and liberating some product particles. But here what happens that the compound nucleus just returns to the ground state by emitting the gamma rays. It could emit one gamma ray, two gamma ray, or many gamma rays. So the compound nucleus emits to the it comes back to the ground state by emitting the gamma rays, and this is called the radiative capture, because here it is emitting the gamma rays. So a low energy particle may be captured by the target, transforming into highly excited compound nucleus, which decays to the ground by emitting one or more gamma rays. So we can see that the helium strikes lithium and the proton strikes magnesium to form the boron excited and the aluminium excited state, and then the boron and aluminium is not disintegrating into any, it is not decaying and giving any particle, but it is giving out the gamma rays. It is just coming to the ground state. So boron excited is coming to the boron ground state, and the aluminium excited is coming to the aluminium ground state by emitting the gamma rays. So this is in the radiative capture. The type of process is, the third type of process is the substitutional reaction. So in the substitutional reaction also compound nucleus is formed, but in this case the compound nucleus thus formed gives out a product nucleus and a some particle which is different than the incoming particle. So what happens here, the alpha particle strike the beryllium to form the carbon 13 isotope, and this carbon 13 decayed by giving out a neutron and a carbon 12. So what we see here that the incoming particle was alpha, but here it is a neutron. If it had given out a gamma ray, then this reaction would have been called as a radiative capture. Since the particles are different, it is not a gamma ray, so we call this reaction as a substitutional reaction. So next reaction you are very much familiar is the fission reaction. So in the fission reaction what happens, a heavier nuclei, a heavier target nuclei splits into smaller nuclei, and the small nuclei though formed are of comparable masses, they are of equal or equivalent masses, and they are also accompanied by the emission of neutrons. You must be familiar with the fission of the uranium, where the uranium disintegrates into barium and krypton and the neutrons are also given off. So this is the fission reaction, and the opposite of fission reaction is the fusion reaction, where the lighter elements are combining together to form a new element, and in this fusion reaction a large amount of energy is also given out. In the fission also the energy was released, but in the fusion also large amount of energy is released when two lighter nuclei fuse together, combine together to form a new element. So the most famous example of the fusion reaction is the reactions taking place in the sun, where the protium, tritium are fusing together in the hydrogen to form the helium, or hydrogen helium are there. So the reactions taking place in the sun is an example of the well-known example, I should say it is a well-known example of the fusion reaction, and the sun is a source of a large amount of energy. So next reaction is the transmutation reaction. So in the transmutation reaction what happens, that the product nucleus that is formed when the projectile strikes the target nucleus, the product nucleus and the target nucleus are not differing from each other by just a few, number of nucleons or a few atomic number, or a few means very very less amount, there is a difference of very less number. So they are differing by just a few number of atomic number or the mass number, means they are very close to each other in the periodic table. So the product and the target nuclei differ by few units of A and Z, and they are accompanied by the emission of one or two nucleon, that is a proton or a neutron, means just they are very close to the periodic table or a photon. So in the photo disintegration, what happens that the reaction will be initiated only when a photon is impinged on the target nucleus. So when the photon or the target nucleus is excited by the absorption of the photon, so the target nucleus is raised to an excited state and the excited compound nucleus comes back to the ground state, not only in the same mode, it is liberating a particle. Okay, it is not that it comes back to the ground state in the same product nucleus and liberating a gamma, but it is liberating some other particle or some other nucleon, and it is different from the incoming particle. So what we have that the deuterium is strike by the photon, or the deuterium is absorbing a photon and is made to excited to a higher excited state, and it comes back to the protium state and a neutron is released. So a proton and a neutron is released when the deuterium is acted upon by a photon. So this is the photo disintegration process. So the difference between the photo disintegration process and the radiative capture is that in the radiative capture, one of the product was a photon, whereas in the photo disintegration, one of the reactant is a photon. So this is the major difference between the radiative capture and the photo disintegration. So next type of nuclear reaction is the spallation. So in the spallation, what happens? In spallation, we see that not only 1, 2, 3 proton or nucleon or a neutron or one alpha particle is emitted, but we see that a large number of protons, nucleons, neutrons are emitted. So the number when we see that is equivalent to 20 to 30 nucleons, or we see some 4 to 5 alpha particles being liberated out when the target nucleus is striked upon by a high energy projectile. So when a high energy projectile strikes on the target and it is capable of emitting out 20 to 30 nucleons or some alpha particles, then we say that the spallation reaction takes place, and the product nucleus thus formed will differ from the target nucleus with a large number of A or Z. So there would be a large difference of A or Z between the product and the daughter nucleus, whereas in the transmutation, the product and the daughter nucleus were not different from each other by a large number of A and Z. So this is the difference between transmutation and the spallation. So next type of reaction is the resonance disintegration. So in the resonance disintegration, if we consider the reaction of alpha P. So alpha P means that the target is struck by the alpha particle and it is able to emit out a large number of protons, and the group of protons released is having a definite energy. So the energy that is carried by the photon is not dependent upon the energy that the alpha particle was carrying. It is independent whether this alpha particle is of low energy, it is of high energy, but the proton that is liberated, the group of protons that would be liberated would have a definite energy always. So this reaction could also be seen when a proton strikes a target and alpha particle is released. So the alpha particles released, a group of alpha particles released will then carry a definite energy and it would be independent of the incoming particle's energy. So when such type of groups are emitted which are having definite energy and they are independent of the energy of the projectile, then we say that we have a phenomena of resonance. So whenever resonance takes place or equilibrium takes place, it is not affected by what is happening in the surrounding. So in the same way, the group of photons that are liberated in this reaction are independent of the energy of the incoming particle and they itself have a definite energy. So this is known as the phenomena of resonance. So the last type of reactions that we can see are the stripping and the pick-off reaction. So in the stripping reaction, what happens that the projectile is fired on the target nucleus, but what happens that the target captures one or more nucleons from the projectile. it strips off the nucleon from the projectile while the remainder continues on its way. So what happens that we have a deuterium, and this deuterium was accelerated to high energy and was subjected to a magnetic field. So what happened that the deuterium's nucleon was stripped off, so it liberated a neutron and a proton was given out. So a proton deflected and the neutron passed straight away. So what happens that from the target nucleus takes or captures the nucleons from the projectile. Okay, but in the pickup reaction the reverse happens, the case that the projectile will capture the nucleons of the target and the rest will go off. So the projectile captures the nucleon or nucleons from the target nucleus. So stripping reaction and the pickup reactions are inverse of each other. In the stripping reaction, the projectile nucleon is captured by the target, whereas in the pickup reaction, the target's nucleons are captured by the projectile. So I hope that all these types of reactions are well understood by you, and we shall discuss some other types of reactions that would be the charge induced nuclear reactions in the next module. So meet you again. Thank you.